Ladies, is it working now?
Okay,
yeah, sure. Yeah? Do you hear me? No? Is it okay? Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for this invitation, dear John Merson and dear Peter Tröge. We met us often in World Council of Renewable Energy, and so I'm glad to visit Australia. It is the first time I'm here. And it is a great pleasure for me and a great honor for me to speak to you today. And I'm very interested in the dialogue afterwards, what we can do then. This dialogue, ladies and gentlemen, is especially important in the context of the efforts to protect the climate and the environment, but also in its potential impact on the quest of a new energy system which could function independently of diminishing crude oil and other conventional resources. One World Summit follows on the heel of the other, no matter if G8 Summit, European Council, World Climate Conferences, East Asia Summit, and others. The energy issue has always been in the center of attention in the past years. To be more precise, the focus is on climate protection on the one hand and energy security on the other hand. But till now, no summit has produced any real solution. Protecting the climate by reducing emission has been the aim, but it has not been achieved yet. At the same time, strategists have regarded the development of crude oil, natural gas, and hard coal resources as key measures to ensure energy security. What they have overlooked is that a strategy like this is inconsistent with effective climate protection. There is only one solution for both climate protection and energy security challenges: the switch to renewable energies completely, worldwide, and within a few decades. The need to replace mineral oil, natural gas, coal, and uranium with renewable energy resources is becoming more and more obvious. Although many oil corporations steadfastly maintain that no supply shortages will occur in the coming decades. However, scientific studies, such as those from the Energy Watch Group, paint a worrying picture. Current studies conclude that global oil extraction passed its worldwide peak in 2006. In the coming years, oil extraction will decline by around 3% annually. This will mean that in 2030, only around 50% of today's level of 84 million barrels per day will be produced. The International Energy Agency in Paris is no longer capable of producing accurate oil forecasts. It claims in its World Energy Outlook 2006 that oil extraction could increase by 30% by 2030. You see it on the slide. The International Energy Agency's long-standing inability to estimate the world's resources accurately is shown by its oil price forecasts, which have for years proven to be inaccurate. For example, as recently as its World Energy Outlook of 2004, the International Energy Agency predicted a long-time oil price of under $30 per barrel in 2008. But today, the oil price soared over $120. The International Energy's World Energy Outlook 2007 was predicting a rapid drop in the price of oil in the short term and the price of just $60 per barrel in the long term. A forecast which can be considered more than far-fetched. And yet, almost all government and companies continue to believe this incorrect forecast. Ladies and gentlemen, the International Energy Agency has in recent years completely failed to accurately assess the situation in fossil fuel resources. The time has come for you all, for us all, to recognize this, and above all, to recognize that fossil fuels and nuclear power will no longer be able to meet the world's energy demand in the coming years. Those who today continue to refuse to invest heavily in renewables and energy savings will cause a serious global economic crisis in which they will also suffer in economic terms. Just as a global oil supply is beginning to run dry, so it is inevitable that the natural gas supply will follow soon. Natural gas is a limited resource which cannot replace oil-based energy production. Coal-based energy production, however, as the most environmental hazardous, should be also abandoned as quickly as possible. The common assumption that coal will be readily available for the next 200 years is false. The Energy Watch Group has verified that within the next few decades, there will already be shortfalls in coal supply. I am fully aware that Australia is the world's biggest coal exporter, has a legitimate interest in further use of coal. Therefore, I respect the efforts to create carbon-free coal-fired power plants. Carbon capture and storage, CCS, is discussed as a solution. Also, Germany supports that technology with high investments from public research funds. An extensive study regarding the possibilities of CCS was published in March by the Independent Scientific Consultancy Office of the German Bundestag, the German Parliament. The key measure is CCS creates a lot of scientific questions, but no satisfying answers. Additional electricity production with CCS requires about 40% more coal. As we already facing resources scarcity and enormous increasing world market prices today, coal-fired power plants with CCS won't have a chance against renewable energies. CCS most likely won't be available until 2020. By then, its changes are even worse. Renewable energies will generate electricity way cheaper than today, and coal on the opposite will be far more expensive. The coal price rose rapidly during the last year, and as a sure indication that the shortage of coal on the world market is indeed real. Finally, uranium is the most limited resources of all. A report from the Energy Watch Group shows that in the next few years, there will already be shortages in the supply of uranium required by the 450 reactors which currently exist worldwide. Atomic energy meets only 2.2% of the world's energy demand. When you hear sometimes 7%, it is also correct, but this is the resources or the share from the primary energy and not from the energy consumption. When you look to the energy consumption, it is only 2.2% of the energy consumption in the world. Atomic energy will therefore never be able to compete with fossil fuel energy or renewable resources. Let's have a look to South Africa. For years, this country has been pursuing an energy policy focused on nuclear and coal energy. Recently, national emergency has been declared because power blackouts had occurred regularly. This is above all due to worldwide coal shortages. Ladies and gentlemen, today we are already witnessing the first climate disasters as a consequence of the rise in global temperatures of only 0.8 degrees. The atmosphere is already overloaded with climate gases, particularly with carbon dioxide. Any further emissions will bring about an additional increase in the Earth's temperature. About 80% of all CO2 emissions are connected to the use of fossil resources like oil, gas, and coal in the energy and chemical industry. Energy efficiency is extremely important to achieve climate protection. But efficiency alone is not enough. Fossil resources have to be substituted by renewable resources when you want a real climate protection. Climate protection must no longer simply imply the reduction of emissions, because this would mean further increases in the concentration of dangerous greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. Climate protection must now mean stopping the emissions of greenhouse gases entirely. At the same time, we have to develop strategies to extract carbon out from the atmosphere to store it in woods or in the ground as humus. A policy for climate protection and energy security can only be achieved through a clear, consistent, and uncompromising policy for renewable energy resources. In particular, this means feed-in tariff laws and tax exemption for renewables. An end to subsidies for fossil and atomic energy. Campaigns for research, development, and education in renewable energy resources. And an end to legal resistance during the approval process. My doubts concerning emissions trading are growing, however. In Germany, it wasn't very successful until today. While laws for renewable energy saved more than 100 million tons of CO2 annually, emission trading contributed no significant amount, with only 9 million tons. But emission trading resulted in 5 to 10 billion euro of unjustified additional profit of German energy companies. Basically, renewable energies bring only advantages and no burden to the world. Climate protection is no burden when we make a right, consistent policy. They create new jobs due to economic development and reduce prices for energy by creating an independent of rising fossil resources prices. They bring a secure energy supply and abolish wars of oil. But ladies and gentlemen, can we actually afford to abandon the use of crude oil, natural gas, coal, and uranium? There is a clear answer to this question. Precisely because the global economy is so fundamentally dependent on fossil resources, it must develop another resource base very quickly. Otherwise, the increasing depletion of oil resources, the drastic rise in oil prices, and the simultaneous exacerbation of the global environmental crisis will precipitate an unprecedented worldwide economic crisis. It is possible to make a fast, total switch away from crude oil, natural gas, coal, and uranium. The natural supply of renewable resources of energy, solar, wind, hydroelectric, geothermal power, bioenergy, and ocean energies offer many thousand times the world's entire annual energy requirement. Enough solar radiation in the particular reach the Earth to meet today's world's energy demand 15,000 times over. You see it on this slide. The red ball is the energy consumption of the world today, annually, worldwide. And the other balls show the potential of all renewable resources. There is enough on the world. is no limited resources until the next 5 billion years when the sun is shining anymore. If only 1% of the surface of the desert Sahara was covered with solar power plants, the whole world population would be sufficiently supplied with electricity. In Australia, there is a huge potential for solar electricity, both solar thermal and photovoltaics, because there are gigantic desert areas with this technology, solar thermal power systems or with photovoltaics. Ladies and gentlemen, it is possible to achieve the goal of 100% renewables worldwide. Several studies have long since shown that entire regions could meet their own energy demand with self-produced energy from renewables. We shall come to produce our electricity, the heating and cooling, and transport fuels too, from renewable energy resources within a few decades. The world's increasing of renewables is very fast. You see it here in the investment amount. It reached at the moment $70 billion in the last year. And the increasing is very, very fast. A good success story that makes hope that we will come sooner and sooner. And you recognize it is not a linear increasing, it is an exponential increasing, and you know what exponential growth rates means. It goes very fast when it comes enforced. But there is one thing that is necessary, namely active political support to accelerate further development. The expansion is now restricted on a few nations. The successful and efficient laws for renewables are necessary for all countries in the world. In the electricity sector, the German and the Spanish Renewable Energy Sources Acts are among the most important and most successful in the world for promoting renewable energies. The growth rates achieved by Germany, Spain, and other countries are very high. And there has been rapid industrialization of renewables, especially of wind energy and photovoltaics. In 2000, the members of the German parliament set the target in the Renewable Energy Sources Act for 12.5% of electricity to come from renewable sources by 2010. We were told that this target was unrealistic and unachievable. And yet, at the end of 2007, a 14% share has already been achieved. This shows that renewables can grow much faster than is often assumed. What is crucial is a political framework such as feed-in tariffs. Renewable electricity is worldwide increasing at such a rate that worldwide energy demand could be met by renewables within a few decades. Evidence for the development of renewable energies is given by the rapid increase of jobs in the industrial sector over the last few years. In 1998, in Germany, only 30,000 persons were occupied in the renewable energy industry, just as many as in the nuclear industry. At the end of 2006, the number of persons occupied in the renewable energy sector had increased to 240,000. Experts expect that around 500,000 renewable energy jobs will be created until 2020. The most attractive political framework is created by feed-in tariffs, which have proved to be remarkably effective measures for the promotion of renewable energies in Germany and in Spain. In the meantime, also in Greece and in Italy, and beginning in France and other countries. A look at laws in other countries reveals that the German feed-in law is the most successful instrument of all. Now I have a problem. The most important slide does not work really. How can we bring these figures? Why does it not work? I should look. Sorry.
There we are.
This here it is. Here it is. Why does it not work when I go to presentation? Okay. It is a new power presentation my office made, and I did not realize that I have to go to the pressure. So you see the increasing rate of wind power in Great Britain, and you know in Great Britain there blows much more wind than in Germany. And this is Germany, the growth rate of wind power in Germany. And look to the argument, the certificate system what promotes wind energy in Great Britain should be the most effective and the cost effective instrument. You see, instead of the fact that in Great Britain blows much more wind, the kilowatt hour wind in Great Britain costs 13 cents, in Germany only 7 cents. So, a clear issue, the feed-in tariff is much more better, effective and cost effective than certificate system. No. And this is Australia in wind power. Yes, you have a big potential like we in Germany too. Look to photovoltaics. This is Japan. Japan begins earlier than Germany with a good policy for photovoltaics in the middle of the 19th. They fetched the research results from Germany and created a big industry in Japan. But they made it only with subsidy, with tax money. And we create feed-in tariff for photovoltaics in Germany without tax money. And you see, after 2000, we overcame the photovoltaic increasing of Japan with feed-in tariffs. And now you see Australia. This is Australia. I can appeal only to the politicians in Australia. Germany alone cannot make the industry revolution for renewables. We need other big countries who have a good, effective basic for industry revolutions, and Australia has a big industry and a good policy for all this. Therefore, we would be very happy if you could support the nations who bring industry revolution. When we come to such an industry in Australia also, this will result in a great technology development in all sectors, in wind power, in solar energy, in geothermal energy, and especially in marine technology. The energetic use of oceans is still to be made accessible. Australia could become market leader for wave, stream, and tidal quite very quickly within a good feed-in law. You see all the technologies and the potential of renewables, what we could achieve. You see, we have a lot of sorts of renewables. And one is marine technology, I can appeal to Australia, take it, you have a huge potential losses. A successful feed-in tariff law needs to contain certain important details. Some countries decided a feed-in tariff, but sometimes it is not successful because they have not the important details. Key components are, for example, the feed-in tariff must be paid for an extended period as at least 20 years. This provides the necessary security for investment. And the feed-in tariff must also be high enough for investment to be profitable. That the investment comes from the investors. When they have only debts, they have no chance to make an investment. And we need a privileged grid access. This is very decisive to entitle investors to connect and feed in into the grid. Because the big companies are mostly the grid owners and they do not allow for new actors in the electricity sector because they want to hold their own electricity production from coal and nuclear and others. The introduction of the renewable energy law in Germany has continued to be controversial. However, substantial counter-arguments have been lacking. All counter-arguments are not sound. The initially high costs for renewables will fall in the coming years, thereby allowing them to be carried by the production economy. Similarly, the law does not concern subsidies because tax funds are not at all involved. The entire financing of the renewable energy law is only through private capital without public funds. The state only specifies the framework for how investment in renewables are able to become economically profitable. The market alone covers the remainder. Thus, no subsidies are paid for through the Renewable Energy Act. Also, the introduction costs for renewables are very minimal. The additional cost for a typical household in Germany would be less than 2 euro per month. All in all, the national economy in Germany has been relieved by renewable energies. While renewables accounted for 3.5 billion euros additional cost per year, over 15 billion euros could be saved due to the reduced imports of fossils, avoided external environmental damage, and lessened cost for emission certificates. The big advantage of feed-in tariff of renewable energy resources, especially for wind, biogas, photovoltaics, hydro, and geothermal, should lead to the introduction of this system all over the world. Also, the advantages of the feed-in tariff system for renewables are well known, there are still resistances. The conventional fossil and atomic energy companies practice enormous background lobbying of their own interests and often against renewables. In Europe anymore. In European Commission, against new laws for renewables and in the German government and elsewhere. The Renewable Energy Act was introduced by the Greens and Social Democratic in Bundestag in 2000 against the votes of the Conservatives. It is a decisive step that now even the Conservatives in German Parliament accept the feed-in tariffs for electricity from renewable energies and consider them as indispensable. Some years ago, this couldn't be expected. During the national election campaign in 2005, The conservatives demanded the abolishment of the feed-in tariffs, but the extremely successful development in electricity production from renewable energies has become to be one of the driving forces behind the recent economic boom in Germany. This fact has convinced even the conservatives. Now, ladies and gentlemen, the heating and cooling sector is also very important for renewables. As far as heat supply is concerned, there is no development of renewable energies comparably of the electricity sector in Germany, unfortunately. For years, the development rate has been stagnating because a Renewable Heat Act is still missing in Germany. The parliamentary group of the Green Party has made proposal for the framework of an Effective Heat Energy Act. The recommendations of the European Commission in January in 2008 are suitable for a rapid development of renewable heat in the European countries, but unfortunately not yet in the German governmental proposal. Also, the cooling sectors is very important, especially in Australia. The most need to cool is when the sun is shining. And the sun is shining very hot. So it is the best way to use sun power also for cooling. Like in this Turkish hotel, it is already possible to cool only with sun. We do not need other electricity. A change towards renewables in the transport sector is also important and possible. There are two important ways at the moment: biofuels and electric drives powered by green electricity. Biofuels got involved in a big discussion and are made responsible for rising food prices, but this is wrong. The main reasons are the increasing oil price, bad harvests caused by climate change, and a huge meat consumption. Land use for meat production is 5 to 10 times as intensive as land use for vegetarian nutrition. Nevertheless, a sustainable cultivation for biofuels is necessary, but only a sustainable cultivation. Disregarding social and ecological farming standards can indeed aggravate nutrition problems. Intensive land use often results in the degradation of soil. Organic farming, however, improves fertility, creates more humus, and so even aids climate protection. Mixed cropping and agroforestry are examples for ecological agriculture with ample harvests. You see, on this field, 3 plants together, and the yields of these fields are higher than from farming with only 1 plant on the field. And the plants are very healthy. They do not need so much poisons and others, so it becomes by themselves to an ecological farming. And we could protect the soil and others. A very new farming method, what some ecologic farmers in Germany created. And here you see traditional agroforest systems with trees, with food, with fiber, and with oil for all, energy production and others. Chemistry based on renewable resources is also important for climate protection. Bioplastic solves a lot of difficulties like resources scarcity, climate change, and waste problems. Genetic Engineering is no solution for such applications because it creates further ecological problems. Genetic engineering is simply no necessary, neither for nutrition and biofuels and no for bioplastics. On this slide, you can see my solar car. The amount of electricity it consumes is rather small. It can be produced by PV solar parks like the one in the background, which is among the world's largest, near to my hometown in Germany, where all people believe there is not enough sun radiation. It is. And this is one of the biggest farms. But I do not need the electricity coming from this power plant. I need only 10 square meters of photovoltaics on the roof on my home to enable my car to run 10,000 kilometers per year. You heard right, 10 square meters for 10,000 kilometers. What is necessary to convert automobiles to emission-free drive system powered by electricity from renewable resources? Also, wind power using for ships is a new successful technology. In Germany, the first ocean liners are driving with skysails. The most important strategy to introduce renewables into transport sectors is to convert the car producers from combustion machines to electricity cars, buses, cycles, and others. But they must run only with renewable electricity. There is a big success story also in the world. Look to China. You will see no cycles with combustion machines in Beijing, in Chengdu, where the big earthquake was these days. I have been in Chengdu some months ago, and also not in Shanghai. But the Chinese people drive powered cycles without oil, only emission-free cycles with lithium-ion batteries, very new technology. And the Chinese companies produce already 20 million electricity cycles per year. Only within 5 years, they could create this industry. I hope that China will come to an electricity sector with renewables and not with coal power stations. But even with the coal electricity produced in China, the cycles are reduced in emissions instead of combustion energies with oil. The transfer of knowledge as well as education are essential factors to meet the challenge for transforming our energy system. To facilitate the worldwide transfer of knowledge, it is imperative that an international renewable energy agency called IRENA be founded. This proposal, spearheaded by Eurosolar, has waited for a long time for political implementation, despite the many resolutions passed by legislators and governments at the national and international level. I would appreciate that Australia and other countries would join the foundation process of IRENA. The German government made a proposal, and we want to found IRENA this autumn, and perhaps Australian government will join this. Ladies and gentlemen, an active climate protection policy, which at the same time ensures energy supply in the long term, makes a complete conversion to renewable energies indispensable. But we will earn also new jobs and the third industry revolution. Let's work together to provide even more support for all renewables and energy savings in Germany, the European Union, in Australia, in USA, in China, and in other countries. Thank you very much for your patience.